Tonight on Beyond the District, a college student's viral tweet raised awareness for a great cause and how a little girl in Texas got a new furry friend.
Beyond the District will return in 2 minutes.
Something's happening to the polar bear. Arctic sea ice is melting away. 2/3 of the world's polar bears will be gone by 2050, and the entire species could be extinct by the end of the century. Go to SaveThePolarBear.org today.
Hello, I'm Casey Lombard, and welcome to TV21's Beyond the District.
And I'm Nikki Garau. Later on tonight, we will take a look at one dog that is ready to go home.
But up first tonight, we'll take a look at how she wasn't expecting it, but a college student ended up raising tens of thousands of dollars for St. Jude's Children's Research. It all started with a Thanksgiving tweet that went viral. Drew Reeves reports.
WSU sophomore Danny Messina got to spend a nice holiday with family. But for many families, that isn't the case, including one of Danny's close friends.
And he's like, oh, you know, like, I spent it with my grandma in the hospital. And so I'm like, wow, like, that's actually a thing that people do. Like, that's actually, like, that's so common.
So she concocted a plan, make her friends favorite and retweet her in exchange for donations to St. Jude Hospital, where many sick children have to spend their holidays. With just about 700 followers at the time she sent the tweet, there was no way to know it would go viral.
Then I tweeted out, I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna give back to St. Jude, and kind of only expecting like 50 retweets, like 100 likes maybe.
Try again. While traveling back to school from Thanksgiving break, that tweet was getting some attention. A lot of attention.
Okay, we're going up and up. And so I got here, I'm like, guys, like, what do I do?
Danny was expecting to donate around $500, but was soon on the line for $50,000, and it kept going. That's an amount no college student can afford. So Danny set up a GoFundMe to make good on her promise. Just 3 days later, she had already raised the $50,000.
I woke up, and someone texted me, Danny, you met your goal. And I literally just started crying.
But Danny isn't finished. Since she reached her goal so quickly, she's ready to see just how far she can go.
Up next, here's an adorable story about a little girl in Texas who gets a new best four-legged friend.
There isn't a day that 5-year-old Riley Brett doesn't think about her best friend. His name, Chicken Nugget, and he was bite-sized just like her.
Look how cute he was.
He now rests near her heart, one with a gaping hole her mother and the community are trying to fill. Today, Riley's sadness is replaced with uncontrollable joy. Today, Riley and her mother meet Chicken Nugget's sister from New Mexico. Her name, of course, is Chicken Wing. Riley says her best friend from heaven made it happen.
I guess you could say he sent an angel to us, so she definitely has wings and made her way to us.
Volunteers drove 14 hours.
Miss Chicken Wing, someone wants to meet you.
To see this moment.
Look at her.
Of course, she remembered the joy she felt.
It sounds just like Chicken Nugget.
With her old best friend. And it didn't take very long.
She's a good pony and I like her.
For the new duo to become inseparable.
She does what I tell her to.
So I know that this is now a new best friend for her and something that she'll get to cherish and remember.
Just two best buds.
My horsey.
She's Riley's little princess and she's a little princess pony and princesses have tutus and tiaras.
Who knew a horse named Chicken Wing could bring everyone's spirit sky high?
It was worth every minute. It was worth every mile driven to just see a smile back on her face. It's the happiest I've seen her in a long time.
Whoa, 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 Chicken Wing.
She'll get to cherish and remember and all the good people and just get to share her love again with this pony.
Come on.
Now, one Michigan restaurant is celebrating Black History Month by serving up some of the soul food it is known for, but packaged in a way that shows what it's like for African Americans during the time of segregation. Saima Chowdhury has more on these shoebox lunches.
This Black History Month, beans and cornbread is celebrating with their food. Picture this. It's the 1940s, and oftentimes African Americans on the go had to pack their lunch in a shoebox like this.
There were oppressive times in the history of this country. Black people were refused service in public accommodations, rest areas, restaurants.
Beans and cornbread in Southfield has been around for 20 years, but when you walk in, you take a trip back in time. And for the month of February, you can order some food for thought.
Walking into a restaurant, being seated, ordering food, and when you think about folks 50, 60, 70 years ago, they didn't have that privilege.
Patrick Coleman says generations of family stories include tales of traveling with lunch in a shoebox. Because of segregation, it was often hard to find an eatery that would serve African Americans.
So if you took the train, say, from Detroit to Nashville, once you hit that Mason-Dixon line, you weren't allowed to go into the dining cars.
For Black History Month, Beans and Cornbread is offering soul food in a shoebox. Inside, you'll find entrees like delicious chicken and waffles. And on the outside are stories of historical figures and facts.
Let's provide some knowledge. Let's tell the stories.
The box costs $1 on top of the price of the meal. A portion of the proceeds will go to a youth program in Detroit. Even though the box represents an oppressive time, Patrick says it pays tribute to the people who lived through it.
Celebrating the resiliency of not only the human spirit, but the American spirit.
Nourishing your mind and soul with this food. In Southfield, Saima Chowdhury for the Now Detroit.
Next, a golden retriever that spent 8 days locked inside of a car is headed home. Sandy was in the car with her owner, who died while driving to Florida, but workers with the Human Society made sure she got back after going through so much. Jonathan Brennan reports.
This is Sandy. Her home is more than 500 miles away, but she found herself here at the Humane Society of South Mississippi after a tragic turn of events.
We have been really fortunate to look after this beautiful soul for the last couple of days, and we are part of her journey home.
Dawn Boob at the Humane Society says Sandy came into their care after she was found in a car on the side of the interstate. She had been trapped there for 8 days with her deceased owner. The Humane Society started reaching out looking for anyone who could claim her and help her get home. Turns out her owner was traveling home to his wife in Florida from Texas, and according to the Harrison County coroner, died of natural causes on the way.
They had one transaction where he stopped at a gas station and then his wife just never heard from him again. So it was just kind of a frantic search.
Friends of the family, Michelle Lonke and Cheryl Jenkinson, got in touch with the Humane Society and a trip was organized to pick up Sandy.
Are you ready to go home? Are you ready to go home? Oh, just such a good girl.
The pair made the trip with the help of their community in the Tampa Bay area, and now they're going back with heavy hearts, but a sense of joy in getting this girl back home. And after going through so much, I have a feeling this leg of the trip will be pretty good for Sandy.
Mom said she could have a cheeseburger on the way home too, so we're gonna make a pit stop at McDonald's. We're gonna spoil her on the way home.
In Gulfport, Jonathan Brandon.
Now, we are going to take a short break, but coming up, we take a look at a group of kids helping out a classmate.
And we'll also take a look at how one California community came together to help someone in need.
When someone abducts a child, they're not about to advertise it, but we will. Sign up at wirelessamberalerts.org to get free Amber Alert text messages on your cell phone. Help put a child abductor out of business for good. Wireless Amber Alerts. A child is calling for help.
Thank you. Hi, do you have ID?
Yep.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Welcome back. A group of fifth graders are working together to help buy a special chair for one of their classmates who has cerebral palsy. Brooke Schuerch reports.
Is it something important?
Are you missing? I gotta go to Mrs. Everson's.
Mrs. Everson's.
Bella Teagues doesn't miss a beat when it comes to daily life as a fifth grader at Mondovi Elementary. Rolling through the halls, this 11-year-old is all smiles all the time.
If someone's having a bad day, all they have to do is look at her and have her smile at them, and it changes bad day into a great day.
But when it comes to Bella's wheels, some activities for the fifth grader aren't always easy.
I just kind of feel bad because things that are really fun, like the playground and stuff, she doesn't get the chance to go and do stuff like we do on it.
Back in November, Bella got the opportunity to go on an empowered dream hunt where she got to use a Trax chair.
It was amazing. She got to go everywhere we did. And without that, she wouldn't have been able to. We went down through a hay field that was waist high and through a food plot, and she got to go right up to the deer, and I didn't even have to carry her anywhere.
Freedom Bella couldn't get enough of.
That was all that was on her radar. The whole rest of the day was, When are we going to ride the chair next? And the next morning was, we going to ride in the track chair tomorrow?
So when members of the community got wind of Bella's newfound freedom, they wanted to make it permanent. And Bella's Smile, a series of fundraisers, was launched, including efforts by her fellow classmates.
It means we get to help our friend, and we know how much she wants that wheelchair.
We're giving Bella something so she can have fun just like all of us.
As funds towards Bella's new mobility pour in,
it's going to be really hard to try to thank everybody properly. It's the most special thing I've ever had happen to me as a dad.
Those who surround her say at the end of the day, it's all about Bella's smile.
That smile's gonna be even bigger than it already is. So this chair is gonna open up like a whole new world for her, and we all better look out, because as soon as she starts driving,
okay,
we're gonna know if she's on the road.
Yeah. Up next, kids are full of energy, to say the least. But a middle school in Los Angeles said it figured out how to help some students calm down in class. As Joe Kwon reports, the solution is really simple.
From this view, it's all business, but let your eyes head toward the floor, and sixth grader Demar Cook is fidgety and wiggly.
I describe myself as a person that have a lot of energy.
His classmate James Morales is also full of energy.
I was really like twitchy and stuff.
Their teacher Sarah Rosati says her students are just typical kids.
Because they're so stuck in the classroom a lot of times, they have all this energy, they don't get to necessarily release it.
So Rosati and other staff at Animo James B. Taylor Middle School search for a tool to help get the wiggles out. Rosati says she searched online and found bouncy bands, thick rubber band-like strips invented by a school counselor in North Carolina.
It takes about 30 seconds to install. You fit one of these over one of the legs, stretch it over to the other side, and flip the desk over, pull up a chair, and it's ready to go.
I really was skeptical, I'm going to be honest with you.
She got some for her classroom in October. Kids who once were
kind of fidgety and having difficulty paying attention
have bounced their way to better behavior in just a few months.
Definitely more engaged,
focused, and even got a big bounce in grades.
Like D's and like F's. Now I got that like A's and B's and C's.
My grades were like down like up to a F's, but then once the bouncy bands came, I got like A's and B's.
Did you think a rubber band can do that?
No, I definitely didn't.
Because the bans have worked, Rosati says other classrooms are also getting them. And now DeMar is hoping to bounce his way to even better grades.
Are you going to get straight A's by the end of the year?
Yep.
Now, a California community comes to the aid of a furry creature. The coyote in question got her head stuck in a jar and needed a helping hand to get free. Steve Large reports.
Well, this is Gold Country Wildlife Rescue, the nerve center of this operation to save this coyote. And tonight, it's a successful operation. The coyote located, rescued, and tonight, it's in isolation behind this door. But we did get a sneak peek. A glimpse at this recuperating coyote. What a relief, her head finally free, and this new picture staring straight into the lens after days dodging help. Video taken last week shows the coyote with its head stuck inside a container, left wandering through the El Dorado County hills, eluding help. The unusual sight led to a growing group of volunteers searching to save her.
Well, I've never tackled a coyote before.
Luis Escobar was one of those volunteers.
It was just amazing that everybody was there and everybody was ready and responded correctly.
This picture shows the coyote just after it was captured inside a crate, the container still on its head.
When I grabbed it and I held it, it felt real bony, like a cat. It's definitely hungry and scared and probably in shock.
Video shows the effort to get the wild animal inside the crate, suffering but still snarling through the see-through plastic stuck on her head.
Her ears are bloody, around her neck is bloody.
Rescue crews later clipped the container off. It looks like a jumbo-sized jar that held some type of snack.
Her head was right in here, and you can see this is probably pieces of her skin.
A days-long effort by volunteers searching to save a creature in pain.
I'm sure she's happy to be done with her bonnet.
Now the search is over. This coyote will be okay.
You've seen an animal suffering, and if you can help it, you know, why not?
And the folks here say they won't be naming this coyote because they do plan on introducing her back to the wild, but I think it's safe to call her Lucky.
It is now time for another break. Coming up later in the show, we'll take a look at how some birds overstayed their welcome.
Beyond the District, we'll be right back.
I stare at my reflection in the mirror. Why am I doing this to myself? Losing my mind on a tiny error. I nearly left the real me on the shelf.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become?
Welcome back to Beyond the District. I'm Casey Lombard. Now we'll check out how Colorado is getting an extended visit from an upstairs neighbor, the Canada goose. Keegan Harsher spoke to residents about their recent population spike.
Good fences make good neighbors. Unless, of course, you live near Quincy Reservoir. In this neighborhood, the neighbors are ruffling feathers.
There are noisy neighbors. It's the loudest thing in the neighborhood.
Raising a racket.
That's the only thing we can hear inside our house.
And pooping in yards.
Like a barnyard.
It's a problem you don't truly appreciate until you take a gander at the skies above.
Every morning the kids are like, the geese are taking off.
But Quincy Reservoir isn't the only place the birds are flocking.
Listen, there's a whole bunch over there just...
Terry Hardy saw a problem piling up.
Everything from caca to calling cards, goo gumbo.
And found a way to turn goo into green.
Move over.
Close to two dozen clients pay her and her colleagues.
Look out, baby.
To spend their days on a wild goose chase.
Walk. There. Okay, that'll do.
And business.
Good girl, Marley.
Is booming. You see, Colorado's goose population is larger than it's ever been because the birds no longer just migrate through the state. Tens of thousands of them are now making the metro their permanent home, in large part because of our mild climate.
The resident population is just growing. It's just exploding. When I first started, I was told that it was doubling every 5 years.
Yes, the word is out. Colorado isn't just paradise for people, it's beautiful for birds.
We do see them every morning and every night.
The place you plan to visit, but end up making your home.
Wrapping up tonight's show, the so-called lilac fire burned through the San Luis Rey Training Center. Dozens of horses died. Now hundreds of grooms who try to get those horses out have lost their jobs and their homes. Many are suffering from physical and emotional trauma. Laura Acevedo reports.
Right now, I'm just listening to his heart.
Dr. Ariel Cortez hasn't stopped seeing patients since he showed up at this makeshift clinic at the Del Mar racetrack.
Ah, okay. Perfecto. Mire, mami.
Chuy Rodriguez lost everything in the fire. He worked and lived at San Luis Rey. Before evacuating himself, he helped several horses get out. But staying behind created a cough.
Y luego me sueno.
And a sinus infection.
Quedas traumado.
He tells me there's also emotional damage. Chuy took us to his room where he slept since Thursday night. All his belongings are donations. He says the first couple of nights were the worst. He suffered from cold sweats, and every time he closed his eyes, he'd see the flames. The clinic is trying to help. The consultation is free of charge, but if the doctor prescribes medication, that comes out of pocket. Someone anonymously paid for Chuy's prescription after his visit. Chuy says the emotional trauma is there. He says that's something only time and being with his horses can heal. In Del Mar, Laura Acevedo, 10 News.
Remember, if you have a story you would like us to cover,
or if you have an announcement about an upcoming event, please send an interschool mail to the TV studio at High School East, or you can email us at tv21@tierschools.com. Also, be sure to tune in to TV21 throughout the day to catch the show and Toms River Schools Today as we bring you stories from around the district. And please take a look at our website, www.tierschools.com/TV21.
Well, that wraps up tonight's show. For Beyond the District, I'm Casey Lombard.
And I'm Nikki Garrell. Have a great night.